you want to be a winner, first you've got to be chosen.
Yeah, Lewis.
Daniel.
Ben.
Matt.
Yeah, D.
Johnny.
Middle, in the middle!
Then, all you need is a bit of skill.
No, you muppet!
Quality, Phil. Quality.
Or a lot of luck.
Johnny!
In it to win it. With the National Lottery draws live. Kicks off next Saturday at 7:30 on BBC One.
BBC News 24 here on BBC One in a few minutes. First with the men's singles final at Wimbledon later in the afternoon. What about the weather? Well, let's find out now from Darren Bett.
Hello there, it's UK weather all the way tonight and some quite unusual weather around at the moment. We're seeing the winds really picking up across the northwest of Scotland. It's going to be blowing a gale here by the morning, very unusual for this time of the year. The wind's possibly 60 miles an hour in the Western Isles. A deep low is responsible. It's been sliding its way up towards Scotland, bringing that shield of cloud, and these weather fronts bringing some areas of rain as well. Let's move things on then and pick up things earlier on in the evening time where we had this line of rain coming across Northern Ireland into Western Scotland. As the rains come into England and Wales, it's tended to just die out, really. Many places dry and cloudy across England and Wales. Warm too. It turns a bit cooler and fresher out towards the west where we break the cloud. We'll see some breaks quickly coming in towards the southwest of England and into Wales, so some sunshine around here from fairly early on in the morning. And we'll start with a bit of sunshine across Northern Ireland, but very quickly I think the shower clouds will gather from the west and we'll soon see some showers pushing in towards the western parts of Scotland. Not quite as windy here as it will be overnight, and we'll start with some sunshine across some eastern parts of Scotland into Northern England. Then we hit that cloud that's coming in overnight. It'll still be there through the Midlands, through East Anglia and the southeast of England in the morning, and it could just give us one or two light showers from time to time. Indeed, it looks like it'll stay rather cloudy, I think, for much of the day for Wimbledon, and there's a 30% chance of a shower in the afternoon. The cloud really struggles to clear away from East Anglia or the southeast. One or two showers here then, and then we've got the brighter skies and the sunshine, and then we've got the showers out towards the west. Now, these could be pretty heavy in the afternoon across Northern Ireland, some heavy thundery downpours, 17 degrees in Belfast, 18 in Glasgow, the southwest of Scotland seeing quite a few showers too, better for the east of Scotland, and it should be largely dry across Northern England with some sunshine from time to time through the Midlands too. Then we've got that cloud rather stubborn through much of East Anglia and the southeast, one or two showers around here, still 22 degrees in London. More sunshine as you head towards Hampshire, possibly the cloud beginning to thicken up towards the southwest of England later in the afternoon, one or two showers beginning to be blown in towards the western side of Wales as well by then. We could well see some heavy and thundery downpours not far away from the southeast and East Anglia overnight. Those should clear away and we'll push those showers a little bit further in towards England and Wales. Quite warm for many of us, a little bit cooler towards the north into Scotland in particular. The heavier the rain should have cleared away out into the North Sea, and we'll still have some showers around on Monday. Some of them could be on the sharp side. Drier weather though for Northern Ireland temperature wise and it stays rather cool and unsettled really for the next few days. Tuesday sees some more showers around, a little bit drier across northern parts of the UK on Wednesday, but on Tuesday as you head further south into England and Wales, could well see some more persistent rain coming in by then before it cheers up just a little bit by the middle of the week, temperatures climbing to around 21 to 23 degrees, but really quite unsettled for the next few days. Rather cool as well, doesn't look much like summer. Good night.
Africa Lives on the BBC.
Hosted by Natasha Kaplinsky, six celebrities rehearse, perform and compete for your vote in a one-off African dance special.
Strictly African dancing.
Next Saturday at 6:30 on BBC One.
The Rat Patrol on the camera. And one reason why subtitles. House full of distractions. What? Interruption? Subtitles?
For more information, call 08703 333 083.
Specials.
It's on the board.
I'm sorry, mate, I can't quite make them out.
One for you, Racket.
Gum, gum.
Right. Have a look. Good?
Illegally, sir? Very handsome.
Right. I'll have the 5OUP. I'll follow that with the F1S.
Think. Can you read a number plate at 20 metres?
The familiar London skyline brings us to the end of a very long Saturday night on BBC One. What a day it's been. Well, later at 6 a.m, highlights of the women's final at Wimbledon, and don't miss the men's final live on Centre Court from 1:30 later this afternoon. But for now, this is Dean Lydiott on behalf of the Late Team here in London, wishing you a very pleasant rest of the night on the day that music made history. We'll leave you now in the hands of BBC News 24.
Suicide bombers in Iraq have killed more than 20 people in separate attacks across the country. At least 4 police officers died in the city of Hilla, south of Baghdad, when a man blew up himself while being searched outside the base of an elite police unit. A second suicide bomber detonated a belt of explosives in a crowd who'd rushed to the scene of the first attack, injuring at least 26 people. Earlier in Baghdad, a suicide bomber killed 17 people waiting to join the Iraqi security forces. The BBC's John Lyne reports from Baghdad.
Another huge death toll from a suicide bombing in Iraq. Relatives of the victims are beside themselves with grief. And these are the survivors. They'd been queuing to sign up for the elite Special Police Commandos, a prime target for the insurgents. There have been so many car bombs at this recruiting centre, no vehicles are allowed in the street. So this time the suicide bomber walked up to a crowd at the entrance and set off a belt of explosives strapped to his waist. Remarkably, Iraqis are still clamouring to join the police. This protest was set off earlier this week when the police turned away thousands of potential recruits eager for some of the only jobs available in Iraq. Also in Baghdad today, Shiite Muslims were raised to a frenzy after one of their leaders was gunned down in the street. It was an attack clearly designed to pit Shiite against Sunni, to pitch Iraq into a sectarian civil war. John Lyne, BBC News, Baghdad.
And still ahead here. Eight of former supporters of the Red Brigades hangs in the balance as France reconsiders its policy on the war on terrorism. Albanians vote on Sunday in parliamentary elections. Opinion polls put the governing socialists and the opposition Democratic Party neck and neck.
Albania was the last European country to witness the collapse of communism. It's come a long way since the early 1990s. The socialists introduced a period of political calm after an uprising in 1997 over illegal pyramid schemes. Economically, the country is no longer the poorest in Europe. Like his opponents, the outgoing Prime Minister Fatos Nano wants integration with the EU and NATO. But his socialists appear to have lost some of their popularity. The challenger, Sali Berisha, might yet make a comeback. He was the Prime Minister toppled after failing to stop the pyramid scandal. But Mr. Berisha appears to have cleaned up his image and is promising transparency and openness. It's a battle of heavyweights who are running neck and neck. The kingmaker could turn out to be the leader of a third force, the Socialist Movement for Integration. But they'll keep their options open until after Sunday's poll. But the process of the elections is perhaps even more important this time than the actual outcome. Free and fair elections will be one of the main criteria for the EU to determine whether Tirana is ready to conclude a stabilisation and association agreement. Future NATO membership will also be determined by Sunday's election standards. Marisha Novak, BBC News.
And the headlines here on BBC News. 5 billion people across the world tune into Live 8, the Make Poverty History campaign. 225,000 people marched through the streets of Edinburgh, urging the G8 leaders to listen. And in Iraq, at least 20 people have been killed by a suicide bomber who targeted new recruits to the police force in Baghdad. The headquarters of the United Nations mission in Kosovo has been targeted in a series of explosions in the capital, Pristina. Nobody was injured in the blasts, which happened shortly after nightfall. Matt Prodger reports from Belgrade.
Eyewitnesses say the first explosion happened in the car park of the United Nations mission in Kosovo, part of a secure compound where entering vehicles are checked for explosive devices as a matter of course. At least three UN cars were set ablaze in the explosion. A short time later, there were two more blasts, one outside the offices of the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, and another outside a Kosovo government building. There were no reports of casualties. In the past few months, there has been an upsurge in politically motivated violence in the province. The president of Kosovo, Ibrahim Rugova, was the target of an assassination attempt in March, and the offices of a political party were bombed soon after. The latest explosions come during a major review of Kosovo's progress since it came under international administration in 1999. The province's ethnic Albanian majority is impatient for independence from Serbia and Montenegro. Matt Prodger, BBC News, Belgrade.
France is threatening to arrest and send back to Italy dozens of militants from the 1980s. The former members of the Red Brigades have been living in France for years, but the war on terror means they may end up in jail in Italy. The Red Brigades tried to overthrow the Italian government. Many have now made new lives for themselves, but Italy wants them back.
30 years ago, this man was one of the most wanted in Italy. Sergio Tornaghi was the leader of the Red Brigades in Milan. He was given a life sentence for ordering the murder of a businessman but fled the country before his trial. He's now settled in France and believes the activities of the Red Brigades are best left to historical TV news programs.
I'm ready to face up to my responsibilities in front of the families of the victims of terrorism. But I also want the political establishment from that period to take their share of responsibility too and say what they did. It's too easy to put all the blame on people like me from the extreme left.
The Red Brigades killed hundreds of people in the 1970s as they tried to overthrow the Italian state and introduce a Marxist government. They even managed to murder the former Prime Minister, Aldo Moro, and his bodyguards. Members of the organization were given a way out of the violence by the socialist former French president, François Mitterrand. He believed the Italian government of the time to tackle extremism and humiliate the left. In an unwritten accord, he allowed members to come to France as long as they stopped political activity. But the deal's now over. The war on terror has changed the political landscape, and they're no longer welcome.
The courts have started sending back to Italy former Red Brigade suspects. And the French government has refused to block their extraditions, saying it's a legal matter and up to the judges. Rome reportedly has a list of key Red Brigade exiles it wants back. Some, like Tornaghi, have remade their lives here. He says he regrets the violence he and others became caught up in and believes his extradition now would serve no purpose.
I'm not sure what I can do to help the victims. They have lost what is most precious of all, someone in their family. I know what I'm talking about. I'm a father with my own family.
He says if he is rearrested, he is prepared to take his fight to the international court. Chris Bachman, BBC News, Bordeaux in southwest France.
Now, there's no better rating in the world of haute cuisine than 3 stars from the Michelin Guide. But with possession of the stars comes the stress and worry of losing them.
Alain de Reims has won 3 Michelin stars for 28 consecutive years. His foie gras ravioli with morel mushroom cappuccino, his viennoise of Brill with Thai spices and popcorn are reputed extraordinary. The way he creates each dish to complement a wine, sublime. There are chefs who'd chop off a finger for all that culinary glory, all those gleaming Michelin stars. Sander Haas is giving his stars back.
There's so much mental stress in always having to be perfect. It's not that I don't still want to strive for perfection, it's just that it's such a heavy weight to bear.
This summer, Sander Haas will change his restaurant into something a bit like this. More relaxed, a lot cheaper than the $500 a head he charges now. It's a big step down, but at least he'll be getting out alive. French culinary history is littered with the corpses of chefs that couldn't cope, from the great 17th century cook Vatel, who committed suicide after a delivery of fish arrived late at a banquet for Louis XIV, to the Burgundy chef Bernard Loiseau, who shot himself 2 years ago after his rating was downgraded by another food guide. France's most renowned food critic won't reveal his face so he can keep visiting restaurants incognito. He says the high-pressure system imposed by the guides doesn't always make for better food.
It's make a very stressed food. I mean, you can feel in the plate that everything is very nervous. You know, there is a lot of character in it, but tension too. It's very impressive, like, you know, museum food.
For Sander Haas, it's time to get back to the simpler things in life.
La liberté. La liberté.
Freedom, no more restraint, nothing superfluous, just the essentials. It's time to see what we can do with sardines.
Those who prefer three-star foie gras ravioli and have $500 to spare will have to hurry. John Lawrenson, BBC News, Paris.
In sport, Venus Williams has won her third Wimbledon singles title. She beat Lindsay Davenport in the longest women's Wimbledon final in history.
Player in this final would mark something of a renaissance, with Venus Williams bidding for a first Grand Slam title in 4 years and Lindsay Davenport aiming to end a major drought lasting 5.5. And it was the 29-year-old number one seed who made much the better start, breaking the Williams serve twice on her way to winning the opening set, in which Williams, the Wimbledon champion in 2000 and 2001, never really settled. Yet she hung in there and somehow took Davenport all the way to a second set tiebreak, aided by a lucky net cord, and moments later by one of the worst line calls of the championships.
30 love.
Davenport thought it was well wide.
If I did my job that poorly, I wouldn't be up here.
Second best throughout that set she may have been, but Williams won the breaker to set up a decider that had seemed unthinkable just 20 minutes or so earlier. The final had become a contest at last and swung even further in Williams' favour when Davenport needed treatment for a back injury. But the world number one responded well enough to put herself within touching distance of the title with a championship point in the 10th game of that final set. Back came Williams, though. The number 14 seed saved that match point and 6 games later served for the championship herself. The longest final in history was won by the lowest seed to take the title, but a third Wimbledon crown will ensure that Venus Williams leaps back up the world rankings once again. Colin Harrison, BBC News.
And the main news this hour. Huge crowds have been attending the Live 8 series of global rock concerts aimed at pressuring the world's richest nations to eradicate extreme poverty in Africa. By the time the main event in London drew to an emotional end, hundreds of thousands of people in the G8 countries and South Africa had attended the shows. This is BBC News.
Hello there. After an unusually windy night across the far north, it's going to become less windy here as we go through the day on Sunday. And for many of us, we'll see fresher skies coming through with some sunshine, but also a crop of showers across parts of Scotland and also Northern Ireland in particular. We could see some quite heavy and squally ones around. But for many, it will start off fresh with some bright sunshine, as we can see across Devon and Cornwall and parts of Wales. But there are going to be some quite blustery winds coming in off the Irish Sea, blowing bring in some cloud, and that'll just hide the sunshine from time to time. And also across Northern Ireland, a dry start here, but those showers are certainly going to crowd in, as we can see across parts of Western Scotland to start off the day. Still fairly windy in the far north, but some brighter skies coming in for Eastern Scotland, many parts of Northern England into Western Midlands. Head further south and east, and we've got a giving us a scattering of showers, and they will gradually push away southwards and eastwards. But I think for parts of East Anglia and the southeast, that cloud and the scattering of showers could hold on for much of the day. Could affect Wimbledon, just an outside risk of a shower, so we'll keep you updated on that. But for many parts of Scotland, England and Wales, it's a fresh and bright look to the day with some sunshine, but a very different story for Northern Ireland and southwest Scotland. Plenty of heavy showers coming in here, really disappointing in those squally winds, but drier, brighter weather for northern and eastern Scotland. In the shelter, it'll feel beautiful, as it will do across northern England in towards Lincolnshire, much of the Midlands. As you can see, that cloud still shrouding much of East Anglia and the southeast with a scattering of showers. But we see brighter spells across central southern England and the Midlands, perhaps clouding over a bit more in Devon and Cornwall, but it should stay largely dry, as it will do across Wales. Just one or two showers scattering around the coast, but we will see some brighter skies. But the wettest place, I think that's definitely going to be Northern Ireland through the afternoon. We could see some quite hefty showers here. And showers is the name of the game again on Monday. Really quite an unsettled feel to the day. It's going to be cool and blustery, but that's not to say everywhere I'll see the showers. It will be drier, brighter weather with some sunshine around, just lifting temperatures up to around 19 or 20 degrees. And on Tuesday too, there's a little bit of unsettled weather as it comes in off the Atlantic. Been lots of clouds around, also some showers, longer spells of rain, but not everywhere is going to see that. Some drier, brighter weather for the far north and also parts of central and eastern England. And here, temperatures responding to the sunshine, lifting up to around 20 or 21 degrees. A little bit more settled for many on Wednesday, drier and brighter, particularly for many southern, western and northern areas. But again, a little bit on the cool side at 20 or 21. See some showers in parts of the north and also the southeast. One or two of them could be on the heavy side. That's the weather for the moment. Bye bye for now.
The environment shapes our lives, from the land we live on to the climate we live in.
Wind farms have become extremely controversial, sparking massive local rows.
Those eggs will now be harvested, thereby helping to ensure the survival of the species.
Tonight, another 3,000 homes are considered to be at very grave risk.
But all these facts and figures mean nothing unless we understand what it means for the country we live in.
BBC News 24. Informed, in depth, in touch.
Stars, when you shine, you know how I feel. Scent of the pine, you know how I feel. Oh, freedom is mine, and I know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life.
A new season of drama, documentaries and comedy coming soon on BBC Two.
And I'm feeling good.
Hello, I'm Deborah McKenzie with the main news. Billions of people are said to have tuned in to the 10 Live 8 concerts throughout the world. In London, many of the stars, as well as the organiser, Bob Geldof, joined Sir Paul McCartney on stage for the finale. Some 200,000 people attended the event in Hyde Park. The authorities have been handing out blankets to an estimated 20,000 people staying there overnight because the show overran. During the final moments, Sir Paul McCartney said he hoped the G8 leaders meeting in Scotland next week would heed the message of the concert and work together to end poverty in the developing world. Earlier in the day, Bob Geldof, the man behind the Live 8 events, introduced 24-year-old Birhan Waldu. She was one of the starving Ethiopian children featured in the original Live 8 concert who survived.
Now, for those who've been reading the press for the last 2 months, who question why we should even try, why we should accept the nullity of cynicism, and why we should listen to the voices of defeat, I'll tell you why. See this little girl? She had 10 minutes to live 20 years ago. And because we did a concert in this city and in Philadelphia, and all of you came and some of you weren't born, because we did that, last week she did her agricultural exams in the school she goes to in the northern Ethiopian highlands. She's here tonight, this little girl, Biram.
Nelson Mandela appeared on stage in Johannesburg. He joked that he didn't make that many live appearances anymore. This message for the G8 leaders.
I say to all those leaders, do not look the other way. Do not hesitate. It is easy to make promises, but never go to action. We ask our leaders to demonstrate their commitment and not engage with hollow promises. We want action. It is within your power to prevent a genocide against humanity. We stand tall and we await your direction.
It's estimated that about 225,000 people demonstrated on the streets of Edinburgh. The Chancellor, Gordon Brown, told an audience in the city that the fight against poverty in Africa was the greatest moral crusade of our times. Other news now, and a leaked document has appeared in the Sunday papers which suggests Charles Clark has come in for criticism from Tony Blair. The revelations have forced Downing Street to insist that the Prime Minister has the utmost confidence in his Home Secretary. The papers say they've obtained minutes of a meeting between the pair during which Mr. Blair apparently questioned progress on anti-social behaviour, prisons and ID cards. A confidential Downing Street report leaked to BBC News says government policies to cut the supply of illegal drugs to Britain aren't working. The study, shown to ministers 2 years ago, says there's been little impact on drug smuggling. Suicide bombers in Iraq have killed more than 20 people in separate attacks across the country. At least four police officers died in the city of Hilla when a man blew himself up while being searched outside the base of an elite police unit. A second suicide bomber detonated a belt of explosives in a crowd who'd rushed to the scene of the first attack. There have been a number of explosions in Pristina, the capital of Kosovo. The first blast happened in a secure compound housing the United Nations mission, where several vehicles were set alight, but no one was hurt. The UN's been running Kosovo since 1999. The Prime Minister is heading to Singapore today, where the International Olympic Committee is holding its final discussions on which city will host the 2012 Games. London is competing against Paris and Madrid, as well as New York and Moscow. The winner will be announced on Wednesday. Earlier, Tony Blair stopped off in Riyadh for talks with the Saudi leader, Crown Prince Abdullah. I'll have a full roundup of news at 4. Now on BBC News 24, Talking Movies.
Hello from New York, I'm Tom Brook. In today's programme, Oscar winner Jennifer Connelly inhabits a ghostly world in dark water. Actor Terrence Howard, whose star is most definitely rising, and a dazzling piece of cinema from a Japanese master. All that and more in this edition of Talking Movies. Brazilian director Walter Salles is a man of formidable poetic talents. Many would say his finest film to date was last year's The Motorcycle Diaries, an odyssey inspired by the young Che Guevara. Now he's made his first Hollywood studio picture called Dark Water, and it stars Jennifer Connelly. Dark Water is based on a Japanese short story by the same author who wrote The Ring. In Japan, it's already been made into a film. What we see in Walter Salles' picture is Jennifer Connelly playing a woman in the midst of a custody battle with her estranged husband over their daughter, with whom she's very, very close.
With her daughter, she moves into a grey New York apartment complex. She begins to question what is real and what is not, as terrifying supernatural forces emerge in the form of dark water.
Well, I think it's a film on the surface. It's a maybe a literal story of the supernatural, of ghosts and haunting, and maybe more abstractly a film about haunting and a woman confronting the ghosts of her childhood and this relationship that she had with her mother, which was abusive and she felt abandoned by her. And now she's a mother herself. She'll sort of pass that on and replay that history.
In a way, I mean, this film, without me being over-flattering, is quite sophisticated for a horror film because you've got somebody who's involved with real-life psychological problems, quite intense ones, and into that you've got supernatural forces injected in a way. Is that the way you view it?
I think that's one of the strengths of it, is that it sort of manages to be both at the same time. I think it manages to fulfill the genre in that way and transcend it. So people who are more skeptics and more interested in the story of this woman sort of going through a custody battle, I mean, it's still a really interesting film. And I think that's testament to Walter's abilities as a director, Walter Salles.
I was going to talk to you about that. I mean, Walter Salles, he is an interesting choice of director.
Mm.
He's made films like Central Station, Motorcycle Diaries.
Right.
Kind of artsy, what people would call artsy independent films. What do you think he brings to this particular film?
I think that really, I mean, it's beautiful to look at the film. And I think it has he has a really delicate touch. I think he's made a film that's frightening because he's really knowledgeable about film making. So he's very artful in that way and can make a film that can have that kind of an effect on an audience, just sort of frighten an audience. But he never stoops to sort of using cheap tactics to scare. It's really chilling and frightening without being just sort of viscerally shocking, you know. And I think it's emotional without being sentimental.
This film is based on a Japanese work. Did you have any concerns about working on it and that somehow when Hollywood gets hold of an original work, it can commodify it or vulgarize it? Did you have any concerns about that at all?
I'm always sort of on the lookout for that kind of a thing. I really like the original Japanese film, and I know I wanted to make something that would compromise it or be disrespectful to it. And I felt that I was entirely safe, and the project was entirely safe in Walter's hands.
Why was the door open?
It was locked. Someone else opened it.
I like Dark Water. It's complex, well-wrought, open to interpretation. You have to work really hard to understand it all. The screenplay would be satisfying even without the supernatural element, just as a story of a possibly psychotic mother trying not to lose custody of her daughter. That there are ghostly forces just adds to the narrative. Walter Salles has done a fine job, especially creating a dark, disturbing mood. But it's a picture that will probably bore audiences looking for the traditional thrills and shocks of a Hollywood horror movie. To its credit, Dark Water is much more subtle. And yes, Jennifer Connelly is very, very good in this picture. Now let me go out on a limb and predict that very soon, actor Terrence Howard will move into big, high-profile Hollywood roles. Haven't heard of him? Well, he stars in two pictures with a strong buzz, Crash and the new release Hustle and Flow. That film has already won a top festival award. Manoush Zomorodi has been to meet the actor.
Terrence Howard has been acting for over a decade, but it's only now with his roles in this year's Crash and Hustle and Flow that Hollywood is taking notice.
Heads in plain sight, step out of the vehicle.
In Crash, he plays a successful Hollywood director dealing with a racist policeman. And in Hustle and Flow, the 36-year-old plays a southern pimp turned rapper called DJ, whose aspirations Howard readily identifies with.
The critics are calling your performance in this film career, groundbreaking, an amazing performance that's going to change your life. That's a lot of pressure. How does that make you feel?
It makes me feel like I accomplished what I set out to do, you know, because DJ's life has also changed in this. This is where the two of us met. And, you know, I felt if I could help him accomplish his dreams, maybe he might help me accomplish mine, and that's what's happening.
I love you, you know. Big love.
Although audiences may not always approve of how DJ treats the women around him or conducts business, director Craig Brewer said the key to making Hustle and Flow work as a film was keeping DJ likable. And that's where Terrence Howard came in.
Tell you, this dog got him some tricks, man.
You mean old dog, right?
I mean it like that, man.
I think the only way that people were going to identify with this pimp is that if he was a true human character. If he was a spoof, or if we were making fun of him, or if we told the audience, hey, it's cool to laugh at this guy, then they weren't going to really identify with him. So I needed an actor. I didn't need a star. I didn't need, you know, a rapper. I needed a guy who was going to create a man from the ground up, and the kind of character last the ages.
I seem to have a sense of heart that people can initially relate to. I don't have the courage behind my eyes, but I have a vulnerability there, and I have a willingness to step myself into circumstances, and that's what I liked about DJ, and that's what I tried to bring to him, a vulnerability, because you think of a pimp as being this hard-line person that's gonna hurt somebody if you don't do what I say. Keep your pimp hand strong, you know, that's everything I hear, and you know, my pimp hand was like a noodle, like a limp noodle.
The two roles that you are really getting most famous for, those are two completely different black men. How unusual is it as a black actor to get the chance to play such a range?
No, I think the chance is there often, you know. As far as it reaching the mass media, you know, people like to look at things that remind them of themselves. And all of these characters are, even though it's a coincidence that they happen to be black, but these are human beings and everybody's able to relate to the human side of their lives.
I'm trying to help you.
I didn't ask for your help, did I?
Howard claims he's not yet ready for the responsibility of headlining a big budget film, but he says he'd be happy to star in another independent project. And even though he's been cast in supporting roles for his next three films, Terrence Howard insists that suits him just fine.
That means we and John.
There can be something quite disturbing about seeing a child star. Witnessing such young talent being guided, sometimes controlled, by adults, often more interested in their entertainment value than their welfare. Well, put those thoughts to one side for a moment while we consider the child star at the heart of Steven Spielberg's War of the Worlds.
She is only 11 years old, but incredibly self-assured. In War of the Worlds, Dakota Fanning expertly conveys a child's eye view of a young girl terrified out of her wits by a Martian invasion. Tom Cruise plays her father. For Fanning, it's a pretty big part. She gives the film emotional soul.
Am I ever going to see Mom again in my life?
Do you feel that it's a move forward for you as an actress?
I think it's, I mean, I can't even believe I got to work with Tom Cruise and Steven Spielberg in the same film. And, you know, just to have their creativity around me was a learning experience in itself, and just getting to watch them, you know, just standing there is like, oh my God, I love the way he stands there. You know what I mean? It's like, just everything about them is amazing and neat to watch.
How do you prepare for a press event like this? I mean, today you've been sitting here at a press junket, dealing with all kinds of questions from different journalists. How do you prepare for that?
You know, I just have fun with it. And I just get to talk about, you know, what I love doing and this movie, which I had a blast working on.
Are there some questions that you find difficult to answer?
No, you know, I mean, I just kind of, you know, I just have fun with it. And, you know, I mean, if there's something that's difficult to answer, you just kind of go with it, I guess.
Fanning's acting career began 5 years ago. Since then, her leading men have included Robert De Niro, Denzel Washington, and Sean Penn, in which she played daughter to his character in the film I Am Sam.
When you look back at your career, I mean, which film to you represents your big break? Was it I Am Sam?
That was my first movie ever, and so I think that was definitely kind of, you know, I guess everybody then kind of saw me for the first time, and I am so grateful to everyone who let me be in that movie, because I don't think I would be here today without I Am Sam.
When you did your first big Hollywood film, I Am Sam. Were you very nervous when you began work on that on the set?
I was so excited. I mean, I was over the moon. I couldn't believe I was going to work with Sean Penn and Michelle Pfeiffer. I couldn't believe it. I was so excited. I mean, just like my trailer when I was in there, I was just like, oh my God. I was so excited. I couldn't wait.
Shirley Temple, Jodie Foster, and Leonardo DiCaprio are examples of talented child stars who've gone on to flourish as adults. Moving successfully from child to adult actor often seems to correlate to a stable home life.
Part of a contract, I have to carry her everywhere.
How important is your family in terms of supporting your acting career?
Very supportive. I mean, this is what I really want to do, you know, forever, and my mom and dad just love it that I'm doing something that I'm happy doing.
Where do you see yourself 10 years from now? From 10 years from now, as an actress?
Definitely still acting. I would definitely be an actress for the rest of my life.
And what actresses do you look for? I mean, older actresses for inspiration. I mean, who do you particularly admire and why?
There are so many actors and actresses that I admire. I love Hilary Swank and Kate Blanchett and Kate Winslet and Judi Dench and Meryl Streep and Jodie Foster. There's so many that I would love to work with one day.
Even if Dakota Fanning never transitions to adult star, and few doubt she won't, she has already achieved a lot. Her name alone attached to a project is enough to get a movie financial backing. That's a power that belongs to only very few top Hollywood stars. Sally Potter is one of Britain's most original directors. She really made a name for herself more than a decade ago with her picture Orlando. A few months back, we heard from Sally Potter on Talking Movies. Now, Manoush Zomorodi has been looking more specifically at her latest film, which is called Yes.
We never hear the characters' names, but she is played by Joan Allen, and he is played by Simon Abkarian. The two are having a passionate affair.
So you see, we're not so different, really. You and me.
I guess I would describe the film as a love story, primarily, that has sort of larger overtones of East versus West. My character is a Western woman. Raised there till 10, went to America. She's a scientist, and she meets a Middle Eastern man who, and they fall in love.
So, you think you can penetrate the mind of God?
Director Sally Potter started writing Yes immediately after the September 11 attacks on America in 2001. It was her response to what she says was the dehumanizing of Middle Eastern people by Westerners and vice versa. Her film never mentions those events, but it is fraught with an atmosphere of turmoil and conflict.
The war is fought inside the soul of man. He struggles doing everything he can to overcome his base desire. The part of him that's animal and has no heart, the set.
None of the characters refer directly to any of the events. They don't refer to 9/11, they don't refer to any particular war or, you know, geopolitical things. It's very much the medium of the political is through the personal. It's through their love, through their conflict, through their domestic situations, through their personal individual struggles. Nevertheless, at the core of it, there's a political heartbeat.
Attraction and rejection, yes and no.
To express this political heartbeat, Potter decided to write the script in iambic pentameter, 10 syllables per line. She felt that verse would make the film's topics more palatable.
I wanted the rich vocabulary that the verse offers and the emotionally rhythmic, musical way of thinking and talking that I think is more similar to the way our brains work, actually, the way our minds work.
Why won't you fight? Why won't you shout? Then we can argue our way out!
When I first got the script and I saw that it was written in verse, I was a little intimidated, is probably the best word. But meeting Sally shortly thereafter and discussing with her thoughts about how she wanted the verse, many people see the film and don't even realize it's in verse. until a good portion into the film, because it's so conversational. And so I knew that she was going for a very conversational element.
So we are at war.
Not only is Yes unusual for its script style, but it's also one of the few contemporary films that deals with tension between the West and the Muslim world. Simon Abkarian, an Armenian actor in his first major role in an English language film, says he understands why there is an apprehension to take on such a weighty subject.
You hear our children's screams, but feel no loss because they are not yours.
That isn't fair.
I think also there might be many reasons. The first of all, there is ignorance from both sides. Second of all, I think there is a fright of not harming each other and say. And third, there is this way of doing, you know, caricatures of each other, you know. And I don't understand why there is only one point of view about such word or such culture or such and many ways of watching people, you know, or deal with people.
The things that they have done have not been in my name. I don't feel pride. I feel a deepening shame.
As for what the critics make of Yes, most of them appreciate Potter's attempt to take on issues of social justice and values, but many of them feel that the film ends up being intellectually pretentious and sterile. Yes, they say, comes across more as a scholarly project than an engaging piece of cinema.
Every so often, a piece of cinema comes along, seemingly out of nowhere, that is quite striking, even breathtaking. Such is the case with the new Japanese film called Princess Raccoon. Seen earlier this year at Cannes, it's now being shown at special festival screenings.
A hot, steamy night in New York. Dedicated fans patiently wait to see Princess Raccoon.
If everyone could please have their tickets out, we're going to be letting people in soon.
This magical hybrid from top Japanese director Seijun Suzuki is without doubt a hot ticket. Word of mouth on the film has been pretty good.
I heard it was very sort of deconstructed and like a dreamscape and full of pop music. I don't know, that's what I heard, like a musical of sorts.
The film, deliberately theatrical, has a very arresting style. On display of
musically, I mean, you're talking Princess Raccoon, it takes in hip-hop, takes in, you know, Japanese traditional folk song singing, bad 80s Casio keyboard disco music, the lousiest ballads you've ever heard in your life, 60s beach songs. It's everything rolled up into one big ball of fun.
As for the story itself, it's about a banished prince who becomes involved with a beautiful princess who, of all things, is also a raccoon.
Seijun Suzuki, you know, everything he makes, in his head, it makes sense. The goal of the audience is just to crawl inside his head with him, and he makes it a relatively attractive proposition.
Thousands of feet of unusual celluloid images have come from the director of Princess Raccoon. He's been involved in some 60 productions. He's not a young maverick.
He's a very old man. He's 82, and I think he's on oxygen for most of the time these days. But he's always been a maverick, but he's been a director all his life for the most part. I mean, he was directing back in the 50s. So this is his life. All he knows is making movies, and they keep getting crazier. I can't wait to see what he's doing at 92.
Princess Raccoon highlights the talents of Chinese actress Zhong Ziyi, with appearances in Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, House of Flying Daggers, and a soon-to-be-released Hollywood picture. She's become an international star. Is Princess Raccoon part of a carefully planned career strategy?
I think she was just looking to work with another one of the big-name Asian directors, who's Seijun Suzuki. And, you know, I think she was certainly probably game for this film. I mean, she plays a giant tap-dancing raccoon. But, you know, performance-wise, she does everything you'd expect. But this isn't something that's going to make people give her an Oscar. She's just there to have fun, it looks like.
Agent Suzuki can count on his fans to see his work, but he isn't a mass-market director. He doesn't aim for big box office, and he won't get it. But what audiences do see is some wonderfully unusual cinema. With this work, is Suzuki trying to offer a